Well, good morning and welcome to our Sunday morning service once more. It's good to welcome you, our Ladyfield friends and fellowship. It's good to come together once again today to worship the name of the Lord. And if anybody's joining us from further afield, we especially welcome you and look to the Lord to help us in what we do as we want to worship God today. And in our opening song, we're going to be singing Great is Thy Faithfulness. And it's a wonderful thing, particularly maybe in a time like this when things aren't going just as we would have planned it. But God ultimately is faithful and God is on the throne, and it's good as believers to remind ourselves of these things, to be comforted by them and thrilled again in the greatness of our God. So let's sing this song together. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee.
Thank you.
commit our time to the Lord now in prayer. Let's bow together as we pray. Lord our God, it is great for us to sing these words together and remind ourselves of who you are as the great and sovereign Lord who rules in the heavens and you hold all things in your hands. We pray, dear Lord, today that we may be strengthened and comforted in the fact that you are God and you still reign. We bless you, Lord, that you are unchangingly faithful. We thank you, Lord, that though in our eyes, as we look around this world, we see many things that trouble us deeply, yet, Lord our God, we know that everything is under your control ultimately. And Lord, we are blessed as we think about these things. So please strengthen us and help us in believing in you and trusting in you today, as we ask you to help us in this service, to be blessed in our spirits and thrilled together as we rest in you and in who you are. So draw near to us and help us in this time, as we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We've asked one of our members, Millie, to give us a little report on how things are for her at the moment. You will know that we are in lockdown, and this is quite a trying time for many, many people. And Millie has a young family, and so we've asked Millie just to give us a bit of a rundown on how she's been getting on in this particular time. So over to you, Millie. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. I hope that you're doing okay. Pete asked me if I would just do a short video about life in isolation and how we're getting on. So here it is. My health hasn't been very good, as you may have seen in the emails that have gone around. And in fact, today I found out I've got another infection. So I'm back on antibiotics, and I was just quite deflated actually when I found out. I thought I was getting better and sort of light at the end of the tunnel, and it was quite upsetting to then find out, oh no, like you're back on antibiotics, you're still ill again. But after initially feeling quite down about it, I have been quite down in general, I suppose, as I've been ill. And today I thought, no, I'm not going to go back to that place. My cousin shared something with me the other day where she'd been having a bit of a tough time, and she ended the text with, but God is still good. Jesus is still on the throne. And praise God, like that is true. And we mustn't let ourselves despair. It's not right, is it? We have to keep our eyes fixed on him. And it really lifted me up. And praise God, I was able to get the antibiotics within like a couple of hours of realizing that I was ill again. And it's absolutely amazing to be able to get that kind of service. And so that was a real blessing today. Another encouragement during this time has been people of our age group, people that have social media, obviously are spending a lot more time on social media because there's not much else to do. And I've realised that things that we are posting, Christian things, are being seen by a lot more people because they've got more time to look, and they're bored, and they think things that perhaps they would usually give a miss, they're looking at, which is absolutely fantastic. And praise God for that. So I know a lot of people aren't fans of social media, but actually during this time when we can't speak to a lot of people directly, it really is a massive gift. It's still a way that we can keep in touch with people and get the gospel out there, which has certainly been a challenge for us. When this lockdown period started, I thought, well, how can we still be good witnesses? And it's something that's really been on my heart each day to think, to make the most of this day for the Lord and not just to get wrapped up in the kids and, you know, little things like getting dinner on the table and make sure the house isn't destroyed by Ezra, to think, well, actually, what's the more important thing here? How can I be a light in these last days. I hope that this is encouraging to you somehow, and thank you for listening. Goodbye.
Thank you very much, Millie, for that. We appreciated that bit of information for us all, and we can continue to remember you, and indeed many others as well, in this particular situation in which we find ourselves. Well, I've asked our brother Steve now to lead us in prayer, and Steve will be bringing the message to us a little later in the service as well. So thank you, Steve, and over to you.
Lord God, we come in prayer for our nation and for our world today. We pray for our leaders, that you'll give them wisdom and strength. We pray for our Queen, and we thank you to have a head of state who has called our people to pray, who has given a message at Easter pointing our nation to you. Strengthen her and bless her, we pray. We ask for the many places where suffering is very great, for rich and for poor nations alike, for all of humanity, whoever they are, and whether they acknowledge you or not, we pray your mercy upon us. We thank you that it is the whole world that you love, that you so loved this world you gave your only Son, because your love is not conditional upon what we are or what we do, but you love us because you love us. We pray for those who have suffered great loss, loved ones, relatives, even children. We think of two amongst us who this week have on successive days been to the funerals of two of their children. Give them the comfort that only you can give, Lord. Give them the assurance that these loved ones are with Christ, which is far better. They are absent from the body, but present with you. We thank you for their strong testimony that they have been able to say that they have known your presence and your comfort in recent days. We pray that you will fill the days ahead in the same way until you bring us back together again, and we can grieve with them properly as we long to, and offer them comfort. Lord, we thank you for the life of Irving Steggles, once the pastor of this church and then in South Africa. We thank you that he's now in a far better place than anywhere in this world. But we remember his brother in London, his cousin in Wales. We pray for them, that you will comfort them in their loss, and his many close friends and the fellowship at Birchley Baptist Church. We thank you, Father, for every person who is working at this time to care for others. Bless them all. Strengthen them, we pray, as they work long, hard shifts, often through the night, often in heavy protective clothing, keeping vigil by the bedside of those who are desperately ill. Keep them safe, we pray. Bless the work of scientists and researchers with insight and skill, so that their work yields knowledge and brings healing. We pray for all those who are cut off and isolated and lonely, for those whose mental health is fragile, for those who have lost their jobs and their businesses. We pray for children missing friends, for parents trying to shield their children from fear. We pray for those who are expecting children at this time, those who have other medical needs, and we pray that you will be close to them and meet every need. We pray that people will turn to you at this time, Lord, as the only source of right thinking and of true security. We pray that the sudden changes we've seen in society will force people to pause and to think and to review their lives and to see that they have been chasing empty things which cannot satisfy. We pray that people will think on you, and that our society will emerge from this time better for it, more thoughtful, more caring, less materialistic, more godly. We thank you for the opportunities which have already been created to speak to others about your wisdom and goodness, because we're confident that you are in control, that you have a good plan for our lives, and that all that is happening is part of that plan. And though we can't see the end from the beginning, we know that you can. So may we know your peace, and may we speak the gospel of peace to those around us. Give us opportunities and help us to take them well. Bless the work that's done through our church. We thank you for those who organise and arrange these things, who've made it possible for us to remain in contact, to remain a family, and to continue to care for and encourage one another. Continue to speak to us, Lord. Continue to mould us and shape us into what you want us to be. May we emerge from this time stronger, closer to you, more like Christ, and better equipped to serve him for as long as this world shall last. Amen.
For our next song, we've got a very well-known song, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds in a Believer's Ear. And surely there's no greater comfort that can bring to us than thinking about our wonderful Lord Jesus, our Saviour, who is our comfort, and he is the rock on which we build. We sing that in this song. Let's sing this together, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds.
Thank you.
it's over to Becky now for our reading from Exodus. And following the reading, our brother Steve will bring us the message. Thank you both.
Exodus 21, starting at verse 33. If anyone uncovers a pit or digs one and fails to cover it, and an ox or donkey fall into it, the one who opened the pit must pay the owner for the loss and take the dead animal in exchange. If anyone's bull injures someone else's bull and it dies, the two parties are to sell the live one and divide both the money and the dead animal equally. However, if it was known that the bull had the habit of goring, yet the owner did not keep it penned up, the owner must pay, animal for animal, and take the dead animal in exchange. Chapter 22, verse 1. Whoever steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it must pay back 5 head of cattle for the ox and 4 sheep for the sheep. If a thief is caught breaking in at night and is struck a fatal blow, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed. But if it happens after sunrise, the defender is guilty of bloodshed. Anyone who steals must certainly make restitution. But if they have nothing, they must be sold to pay for their theft. If the stolen animal is found alive in their possession, whether ox or donkey or sheep, they must pay back double. If anyone grazes their livestock in a field or vineyard and lets them stray, and they graze in someone else's field, the offender must make restitution from the best of their own field or vineyard. If a fire breaks out and spreads into thorn bushes so that it burns shocks of grain or standing grain or the whole field, the one who started the fire must make restitution. If anyone gives a neighbour silver or goods for safekeeping, and they are stolen from the neighbour's house, the thief, if caught, must pay back double. But if the thief is not found, the owner of the house must appear before the judges, and they must determine whether the owner of the house has laid hands on the other person's property. Verse 22. Do not take advantage of the widow or the fatherless. If you do and they cry out to me, I will certainly hear their cry. If you lend money to one of my people among you who is needy, do not treat it like a business deal. Charge no interest. Chapter 23, verse 5. Do not spread false reports. Do not help a guilty person by being a malicious witness. Do not deny justice to your poor people in their lawsuits. Have nothing to do with a false charge, and do not put an innocent or honest person to death, for I will not acquit the guilty. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe blinds those who see and twists the words of the innocent. Do not oppress a foreigner. You yourselves know how it feels to be foreigners, because you were foreigners in Egypt.
Well, we've read the passage from the Old Testament, which is a part of the law that was given to Moses. But these talks are titled Love and Law. And the love, which is such an important part of God's law and of the Christian life, is explained more fully in the New Testament. So I want to start by looking at a few New Testament verses which set what we've read in a Christian context. So the first of those is Galatians 3 and verse 19, which says that the law was added, that it was added because of transgressions, and that it was added until the seed should come to whom the promise was made. Now, first, then, the law was added. Now, that means that it was added to something. It was added to what people already had. And we saw when we looked at Exodus 18 that Moses already had an understanding of God's will and a basis on which he was judging people. And that understanding would have come through the patriarchs, through Abraham, through Noah, through Adam, and have been handed down through the generations. Moses had that, but Moses now had appointed judges on his father-in-law's advice, again, Exodus 18, and those people needed a basis on which to make their judgments. There was a new society. They were about 3 months into their wilderness journey when these laws were given, and they needed a law. They needed it clearly written. They needed to all understand how it worked. And they needed that as a basis of living together, as all societies need law. As Christians, we uphold the rule of law. We acknowledge and recognise the need for a law-abiding society, and we abide by its laws ourselves, so that we are not meeting together today, because the law says that we can't. We'd very much like to, but we don't. We are not sneaking into Sainsbury's during pensioner hour, at least those of us that aren't pensioners aren't. Anyway, we are abiding by the law. But laws keep being added even today. A few years ago, it was legal to fly a drone anywhere you wanted, over your neighbour's garden or in airports, because they've just been invented. The law has caught up with the transgressions. And that's the same process that we're reading about in Exodus, of law being added because people are, by nature, it seems, lawbreakers. Humans, by nature, do things to upset one another and to harm one another. And the law is good because it is there to stop that. And then the third thing that this verse in Galatians tells us is that the law was added for a finite time. It was added until the seed should come to whom the promise was made. Now that seed was Christ, and that's who it refers to. That means that this Old Testament law no longer applies in the same way to us. Alistair told us last week that Jesus said not one part of it would pass away. However, it does not apply in the same way. It is not given for us to live our lives by today. Here is the second New Testament verse that I wanted to talk about briefly. It's also from Galatians, and it's also about the law. The word law is the last word that you can see on your screen. It says that the fruit of the Spirit is love. And remember, it's love and law that we are talking about. I heard somebody say once that all of those other words are things that flow out of love. Joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. All of those things are what we should be displaying if we have God's Spirit in us. And of course, there is no law against any of those good things. These are the things which should characterize us as Christians. If you were a Christian extremist, then you would be extremely loving, extremely joyful, extremely peaceful, extremely forbearing, extremely kind, good, faithful, gentle, and self-controlled. That's the Christian faith in a nutshell, or in a fruit skin, you might say. And that is an explanation of why we don't need the law. Because we are supposed to be showing all of those things, regardless of what the law might say. We go over and above, we go well beyond the law, or we should, because God's Spirit in us prompts us to do that. And this is what is meant when the Bible says in Jeremiah 31, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their heart. hearts. And those words are repeated twice in the New Testament in the book of Hebrews, in chapter 8, verse 10, and in chapter 10, verse 16. So now we understand what Jesus meant when he was asked about the law, and he replied like this: Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. Love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law. So you see here that love underpins and underlies the law, and the whole law depends on love. Love is the great guiding principle behind the law. If we don't love our fellow man, we're not going to be keeping the law, even if we pay lip service to it. The whole thing depends on our attitude and our approach. And that's what the New Testament is really all about. God living in us, giving us the ability and the desire to live a life of love, rather than being regulated by the external conditions of the law. We're driven from within by love to do what we should to our fellow man. And so we return to the passage that we read in Exodus chapter 22 and some verses either side. This chapter, when you read it and take it as a whole, well, I think what strikes me most of all is the justice that there is here. When you read these rules and these laws, you naturally ask yourself, are these things that I agree with? Now, that's not really an attitude we should bring to God's word, but it's a natural thought process as we read through chapters of rules and regulations like these. Now, as I read through this chapter, what went through my mind was how similar these rules and laws are to rules that we have today. How fair they sound to me, who lives thousands of miles away and 4,000 years away from where these laws and rules were given. So the chapter deals with all sorts of issues. It deals with theft and taking retribution and accidental damage and making restitution for things you've done. It deals with animals which are stolen. It deals with animals that are injured. It deals with animals that injure other people. It deals with breaches of trust and fires that run out of control. And it deals with marriage issues, and it deals with how to treat foreigners and how to treat widows and orphans, and about lending money, and about gossip and slander, and about respect for rulers, and about perjury, and about bribery, and about good neighborliness. All of those things. And then somewhere in the middle, there's a couple of verses about witches and about people who worship false gods. And those two little verses would probably raise an eyebrow in 21st century Britain. But the overall sweep of the chapter is remarkable for how just and natural and normal it all sounds. If you think that these rules were given to people in a desert 4,000 years ago and far away. So that similarity leads me to ask some questions. Leads me to ask of myself the question, where does law come from? Well, obviously, in this instance, it came from God, and that's pretty obvious. But our laws in our society today don't come from God, they come from Parliament. But behind that is a question of, what do we think of as right and wrong? And why do we think those things are right and wrong? And why is there so much agreement between what God said 4,000 years ago and what we think today. Now, that's really important, actually, if you're running and organising a society. It's important that laws are fair and just and that people think they are. So we see in this chapter a couple of times it's emphasised that the children of Israel should treat foreigners well, and the reason is given. It is said, because you were foreigners in a strange land and you know what it's like. And an appeal is made to their own natural reason. It's important because you want people to obey laws. There's no point having laws that nobody's going to obey because everybody thinks they are unjust and unfair. But of course, God was giving these laws. And when God gave these laws, they came from a thundering mountain, and they came from a God who led them with a pillar of fire and of cloud, and they came from a God who had led them through the Red Sea miraculously and delivered them from Egypt and so forth. So these laws came with authority, and these people were very much inclined to accept these laws because they could see the power of God behind them. Now, people today don't see the power of God. They don't necessarily accept that there is a God, even. So they don't accept that that God has the right and the authority to set our laws. And so we have a number of laws which are at variance with what we would say as Christians, it is a righteous and a just society. But on the other hand, an awful lot of our laws, we would say, as we've seen today, are exactly in line with God's principles. So we should be very grateful that we live in a society where that is the case, and we should uphold that law. And of course, this is all because our laws are based on Christian principles. But it's also because there is something in us that knows what is right and what is wrong, and that thing is called conscience. God speaks to us through our consciences. We have a sense of what is right and what is wrong, and that's not always perfect. That needs correcting, that needs guiding by God. But still, it exists within us all. There is, since the Garden of Eden, a knowledge of good and evil in all mankind. Now, that concept is called by philosophers natural law. And this idea that natural law has been given by God has underpinned lawmaking from the earliest times, even from the ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle and through a famous medieval philosopher called Thomas Aquinas, through to even Thomas Hobbes of Malmesbury, who lived around the time of the Civil War in Malmesbury, and he saw the town change hands multiple times during the war, and he saw the impact of lawlessness, and he said that without an ordered society, life would be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish and short. Those words he's famous for writing reflect his experience. Law is actually very necessary for us to live together in society. But since those days, an atheist school of thought has developed, which is essentially that there is an authority, there is a power, and what law does is it brings sanctions. It makes people comply, and they must comply because otherwise the authority will impose a punishment upon them. Now, that philosophy of law just omits the idea of natural justice, and the risks of it are that it creates an oppressive society. It creates a society perhaps in which people do not necessarily want to comply with the laws, but they have to. And so during the 20th century, we saw a number of countries develop in that way, in godless societies, and they became very repressive societies. Whereas those societies where conscience was emphasized, where freedom of religion was emphasized, where Christian truth was emphasized, were free. And that continues still today. When God gave laws to Israel on Mount Sinai, that was something which has never been repeated since. Israel was a society unlike any other. The technical term is a theocracy. You've heard of democracy, where that means the people decide and choose. Well, theocracy is where God decides and God is in control. Now, Israel was the only theocracy. Certainly in the Bible, you could make a case to say that other countries today, Saudi Arabia, perhaps Iran and so forth, are theocracies. But by God's laws, Israel was that. They lived according to his rule. And that is why you see those two verses I mentioned earlier, verse 18 and verse 21, I think it is, about witchcraft and about worshipping false gods. Now, those things were completely unacceptable in Israel. The nation of Israel were a people taken out of all the other nations for God to be a pure and a holy people. And of course, they were not to worship other gods. And witchcraft was really just a form of worshipping other gods, other powers, satanic powers. And as Christians, of course, we wouldn't do those things either. And we look forward to a new heaven and a new earth where Christ shall reign on earth. And at that time, there will not be any witchcraft, there will not be any worship of false gods, because we will all know God. So those rules and those conditions pertained in very specific times and places. Today we live amongst people of all sorts of religions and persuasions. We show them love, we seek to reach them with the gospel, and when we do, at that point Christ writes his laws on their hearts, and they want to live in the same way that we want to live. As we do that, we proclaim a God who is a God of justice, a God who is fair, a God who sets rules that are right and are good. Think of all the evil regimes that have arisen over the past 4,000 years around the world, the terrible things that people have done to one another. Well, God's law here in Exodus stands as a beacon throughout time of what is right and what is good. This passage has underpinned laws in free countries for thousands of years, and it is good and it is right, and we stand in the light of that when we proclaim our God to other people. And of course, it's all summed up in what Jesus said. It is about loving God, and it's about loving our fellow man. But we're going to return to Galatians to finish with, just to see that God had a far greater purpose than that in the giving of the law. It was not just about making this life better. It's much more than that, about setting right everything that's done wrong and all the consequences of our wrongdoing in this life, and enabling us to live in eternity with Christ in that heavenly kingdom where he rules in justice. Here we come to the ultimate purpose of God's law. It was to show us that we are imperfect. It is to show us that we're sinners, that we're lawbreakers. It's to show us that we need Christ. We know what's right. We have that innate sense, and that innate sense of right and wrong, knowledge of good and evil, is supplemented by the fact that God has given the law, making it very clear what is right and wrong. And not one of us has ever kept God's law in all its fullness. But thank God, God is love. And because God is love, Christ came to die in our place, to suffer the penalties that were due to us because of our sin. Nobody was ever going to be justified, made right in God's sight by the law. But look at this verse. It says that the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ so that we might be justified by faith. And it is only by faith, it is only by believing in what Christ has done for us that we will ever be justified in God's sight, that we will ever be made right and fit for heaven. Even as God gave this law, he knew what its implications would be. Its implications would be that his own son would have to die to meet the demands of this law. God, in his love, did this. As the Bible tells us, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen.
Well, thank you for the message, Steve. We greatly appreciated that. Well, as we come to a close now, we're going to sing a closing song. This is another new song, as it so happens. This is by the Gettys. It sort of appeared this year. Christ, Our Hope in Life and Death. It's a beautiful song. Let's sing this together, or listen to it, perhaps, if you've not heard it before.
Christ is ours forevermore.
Song. We'll just close our time together now in prayer. Let's bow together as we pray. Lord our God and gracious Father, we are so blessed to have been together in this way, in a slightly different way to what we would perhaps choose. Yet we do thank you, Lord, for the technology that enables us to still have fellowship in this particular way. We pray, bless your word to our hearts and to our understandings. We ask, Lord, that we may hear your voice speaking to us and that we may grow in grace and in the knowledge of yourself. Please do take care of us, each one in our different lives and situations. Pray, protect us, Lord our God, even from this virus, that you'd watch over us and keep us safe in your great mercy. Dear Lord, we pray. And we ask as well, soon, that in the coming days, Lord, there may be a better situation with reference to this virus, so that people may not have this distinct anxiety with reference to it. Yet, Lord, bless this time. Have mercy upon us as we commit ourselves to you. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.